Meta just announced they're planning to develop dozens of AI personality chatbots, and that they're also working on letting creators and celebrities create their own AI-powered chatbots that can interact with their followers and their fans.
Today, we're going to create an avatar that looks and moves like me.
I am not Morgan Freeman.
Oh, what a task you set for me.
But here's why this is actually really important, and it's not just Meta doing this. Tech companies are making a huge bet that AI chatbots will play a massive role in our futures. So not only will we all have digital twins and digital doubles that represent us in digital spaces, whether that's on social media or on dating apps, or even sending our digital doubles to meetings if we're too busy or our schedule's packed, but also that each of us will have our own personal AI chatbot and assistant that follows us through life and helps us with everything we do. So think of it this way. What would your life be like if you had five assistants that helped you with anything you needed in your personal or your professional life, and one that could attend work meetings on your behalf and be in a few places at once if you're super swamped? That is the vision tech companies are trying to bring to life through AI-powered chatbots. You can kind of imagine the movie Her, but without the romantic stuff. I'll touch on that at a whole other time. But Apple, Meta, Google, Microsoft, all fiercely competing to build chatbots that will become your everything. Your assistant, your chief of staff, your friend. And in some ways, this could be amazing. But imagine the intimate data we're putting in the hands of these companies and the potential for things to go wrong in a world mediated by chatbots. So let's explore the future of these digital assistants. I'm gonna tell you where things could be going, the areas that could be really cool, and the things we might need to watch out for.
AI stuff is Sinead Bovell.
Sinead Bovell.
Sinead Bovell.
Sinead Bovell.
Hi, I'm Sinead Bovell and I'm a futurist, and I wanna take you into this world with me. So in terms of what chatbots even are, AI chatbots like ChatGPT or the ones tech companies are currently creating are built very differently from chatbots like Siri, sorry Siri, or the chatbots you probably hang up on every now and again with customer service. AI chatbots like ChatGPT and Google's Bard, they learn by reading almost everything that's been written on the internet. And from there, they can spot patterns in human language and predict what word should come next in a sentence, which is why they're so good at generating human-like sounding text on their own. They've been trained on massive amounts of human written text. And these chatbots are already transforming our internet searches. I mean, today, you can take a photo of your bedroom and ask an AI chatbot for design ideas and the shopping links to those ideas. If you're looking for a new recipe, you can take a photo of what's in your fridge and chatbots will reply with a recipe. You can take a photo of a strange rash and ask, is that a bug bite or is it something else? And instead of perhaps Googling how to get in shape and receiving a bunch of links that you have to sort through, a chatbot would just reply with the actual meal plan and workout plan. But these kind of general chatbots are only just the beginning.
Where everything becomes an AI, I think you as an individual consumer want to have a personal AI that is on your team, right? It is fiduciary aligned to your interests. In your corner.
That's Mufasa Silliman. He was one of the co-founders of one of Google's main AI labs called DeepMind. And then he went on to build Inflection AI, which is what he's talking about there. So it's one of the companies building personal assistants for every one of us, kind of like a digital friend, and I'm gonna touch on that word later, or a smart intern that doesn't actually clock out at 5. Instead, these digital assistants, they follow you through your life. And since it's been trained on basically anything that's been written on the internet and likely eventually refined on your data, you can ask it for advice on pretty much anything you would have usually searched for on the internet. But these personal AI assistants, they're going to be a lot more proactive and what's called agentive. So the vision companies have is, for example, your AI would see that you're running late in a work meeting and it would text your neighbor on your behalf, can you do school pickup? Or instead of trying to figure out the best home insurance plan for your new city, your AI assistant will not only do the research for you, but actually call and negotiate the best plan for you. And they may be interacting with other human insurance brokers or other AI systems from those insurance companies. Your personal AI chatbot could edit your YouTube videos or connect with other AI systems that can do that editing, or help you lay out the blueprint for your next book. It would listen and offer support if you're going through a bad breakup, encouraging you maybe to get back into your weekly therapy sessions or even acting more as a motivator and as a coach. In the case of Pi, for example, the assistant from Inflection AI.
Hey there, I'm doing great. Thanks for asking. And it's a pleasure to chat with you. So nice to meet you. How are you doing?
Your digital chatbot works just for you. It isn't actually trying to sell you something. So it's likely been refined on your data, you pay a monthly subscription for it, and just moves along with you through life. Apple, Google, Microsoft, the list goes on. They're all trying to build these interactive personal assistants. But it doesn't stop there. AI chatbots are gonna play a really big role in the workforce, and I'm gonna tie this into Meta's chatbots in a little bit. So every company will have AI chatbots that have been trained virtually on every company document, social media post, office memo, campaign, and it will assist the entire workforce in any capacity that it can. So maybe you have a superstar chatbot on your marketing team that has analyzed all the data from every social media post, every marketing and advertising campaign, and that's constantly scanning the market for competitors. And then you get to ask for this chatbot for advice on something that you're building, to draft examples of advertising campaign and copy. The list goes on and on. So we'll see the rise of these super powerful teams because every team will have a dedicated AI on it. But then there's our personal professional chatbots or our digital twins in the workforce. So your professional chatbot has likely been trained on your data, so it sounds a lot like you. It knows the work you've completed and what you do. So you attend your company meeting with your professional digital twin, and after the meeting, you would debrief together and divide and conquer on the deliverables. Your digital twin could go to meetings on your behalf if you're unavailable, or say maybe you're a lawyer and you have a huge wait list for prospective clients. Your digital twin could do the preliminary meetings, and any client that it says you could actually take this case on, then you do the human in-person meeting. It could draft emails on your behalf and save them in drafts for your review so you can wake up Monday with those emails already written, ready to go. And you may have heard of Karen AI.
So this AI chatbot will be your girlfriend for $1 a minute. It will talk to you, flirt with you, and even send you selfies.
A Snapchat influencer who built an AI chatbot that her fans could interact with 24/7. So this chatbot, it could send them selfies and it could remember who each fan was. I'm sure you can imagine that with her 98% male fan base, the nature of these messages got pretty sexual, pretty dark real quick, which is incredibly problematic, unsurprising unfortunately, and definitely a topic for another day. But outside of all of that drama, Karen AI won't be an outlier. More of us will have digital proxies that represent us in digital spaces like social media or dating apps. So your chatbot on LinkedIn would have a very different personality than the one on your Instagram or the one on Snapchat or the one on your Tinder profile. Well, at least I hope they would be a little bit different. But this is already happening, for example, in China, where digital twins of influencers carry out sponsored advertising on their shopping channels at all hours of the night. And companies, as I mentioned, including Meta, Snapchat, they're already building these AI chatbots into their platforms. And so for the next step would be for each of us to power our social media profiles and our digital profiles with these AI interactive capabilities. And all of this could be really cool and make us a lot more efficient and save us a lot of time in our physical human world. But before we march down this path with chatbots, there are a lot of red flags and potential dangers we need to think about. Chatbots are not a blank slate. Recent research from MIT reveals that these digital aids can harbor a lot of political biases that's rooted in the data that they were trained on. So Google's BERT, for example, it was trained on a lot more books, which tend to be a bit more conservative. And then you have OpenAI's GPT systems, such as ChatGPT, and those were trained more so on the internet, which has in some ways more liberal views. And then, for example, Elon Musk said he's creating his own chatbot called TruthGPT, which means depending on which company made your chatbot, it could influence your ideas and your views on topics like political candidates or abortions. And we could start seeing the world through the eyes of our personal AI systems, which really shrinks our context window of reality. And then all of the racial, gender, and other biases that were in those data sets that the chatbots were trained on, they could be reflected in the answer that your chatbot gives you. And when you think about the intimate data that these systems are going to collect about us, it's kind of at a scale that's hard to imagine. And so if we don't have proper regulations in place that enforce privacy and security, it's a pretty big trade-off to be making. And despite companies describing chatbots as our friend and our companions, they aren't our friends. They are AI systems that we don't even fully understand. I mean, as American psychologist Sherry Turkle shares,
you're having conversation with something that knows how to pretend empathy, that's with something that knows what to say. It's the illusion of companionship without the demands of intimacy.
So we need to reflect on the trade-offs we make when we replace authentic human connection and all of the complexities that go with it with systems that aren't fully capable of actually understanding or empathizing. It's more just the illusion of empathy. I mean, there is evidence that shows in some circumstances, chatbots can help alleviate loneliness, especially when it comes to older adults. But again, if you look at social media, we're way more connected than ever before, but in some ways we're lonelier. And consider Yuval Noah Harari's point of view. Language is the operating system of humanity. It shapes our relationships with one another. It shapes how we coexist on this planet together. Now we're passing that capability to AI systems that we don't fully understand, which could have grave consequences. I mean, remember Blake Lemoy, the Google engineer who lost his job at Google because he believed one of Google's systems, AI systems, was alive because of the AI's ability to mimic human language to an eerie degree. Imagine this trend gaining momentum and people forming strong emotional attachments to their AI companions to the extent that they jeopardize their careers, their relationships, and their grip on reality. Even more alarming is the prospect of these AI chatbots falling into the wrong hands. I mean, imagine an aspiring dictator or an aspiring religious leader who creates an AI chatbot that sounds incredibly warm and empathetic and sounds like a very charismatic leader and can then amass a large following using the power of these large language models. And finally, chatbots are prone to errors. I mean, they straight up make stuff up and lie all the time, and it's mostly a property of the current way we build these large language models. And this could certainly change over time, but until we figure out a way to make these chatbots more about critical thinking and reasoning instead of more so predicting words that come next in a sentence, they're not going to be entirely reliable or trustworthy. And this could bring out dire consequences if somebody was, for example, turning to an AI chatbot for health advice and then not seeking any answers or support from an actual medical practitioner, or even just doing homework problems. I mean, it could lead you entirely astray. So understanding the limitations and the potential pitfalls of these chatbots, it's paramount to our future with AI. Because these systems, they could help us free up so much time, discover a lot of new insights in our personal lives and in our work lives, but we also have to consider the risks this technology presents and establish the boundaries we want to place around it. And also decide, is this the future we want to walk towards? So the more aware we are of the benefits and the risks, the better equipped we are to make informed decisions about how we want this technology to evolve, and to hold companies that are building these systems accountable, and to ensure that these tools work for the benefit of us, and not the other way around.